Titanic, 2:17 a.m. The ship rises to a high angle. Then it happens. Titanic breaks in half, crashing and settling down back on the sea. People have claimed it, seeing it broke in two pieces or into sections. But what exactly are these sections? In the wreck, we can clearly see that there are multiple debris, the aft tower, the forward tower, and the stern and bow sections, along with the double bottom and many more. But how exactly did these pieces become to be? This will be covering how exactly these pieces came to be. Titanic is known to be one of the strongest and known to be an unsinkable ship in the world. But why did it sink? Why did it break into sections? What are these superstructures that we call the aft and forward tower? An expansion joint or movement joint is an assembly designed to hold parts together while safely absorbing temperature-induced expansion and contraction of building materials and vibrations. Some of these are used as well in ships back in the days. Titanic was built with two expansion joints. These joints allow the superstructure to flex on top of the structural hull. The heavy shear strake plating between C deck and B deck formed the top of the structural hull proper. Even if above the level of the deck was superstructure and was built of light plating, none of it was intended to take any degree of severe stress. The superstructure of a ship is deliberately designed to not interact meaningfully with structural hull. The three decks of superstructure on Titanic did prove a modest amount of additional stiffening in the overall cross-section of the ship. The expansion joints then represent a sudden decrease in the cross-section of the ship for one frame at which they occur. This also represents a slight dip in the neutral axis directly above a discontinuity in the double bottom. The forward joint was located just behind the first funnel, and the after joint was located between the third and fourth funnels. These expansion joints help and hold the Titanic together to avoid breaking in half while sailing across the sea. The superstructures. The aft tower. It consists of mostly portions of the decks around the boat deck, A deck, B deck, and C deck. Although it is suspected to lie upside down, some landmarks include Thomas Andrews' bathroom heater. This also includes as well the aft grand staircase. It was mostly likely the aft tower broke off like the forward tower at the surface or during its descent down the seafloor. The location is on the wreck of the aft tower is located to be estimated of about 200 feet north of the stern. The forward tower. This tower or superstructure consists a lot of major debris like the coal bunker, the galley deck section, the base of the third funnel and the funnel itself. The middle section or the forward tower is scattered in large chunks towards the northeast as the current pushed in that direction. It is believed that the middle section probably detached from the stern after the breakup gradually broke up into more pieces as it descended and went down towards the seabed and was carried towards northeast and with the current and landed far away from the stern, which was heavier and would have not been pushed so easily by the current towards the northeastern direction. Roy Mengot. The physics of Roy Mengot. The breakup process has to sink the stern. Any clean break through the ship will leave the stern floating as its own ship, or at worst, restart a flooding and sinking sequence that could take much longer than mere minutes. That didn't happen. The keel did not behave like 5 feet shoe of leather. The cellular double bottom is designed to be rigid and therefore was brittle. Once you've accounted for all pieces, you have to account for the forces that made them pieces. Steel doesn't just come apart. There has to be a force or major stress that breaks steel. This is where top-down breaks are weakest. Once the stress of the tipped predicament breaks the ship top down, all the stress and energy required to break other portions of the ship are gone. Steel structures do not flake off or pop off in the current during descent. Parts cannot be thrown off by centrifugal force from a rotating stern section, as it will never spin fast enough. Gravity is neutralized if both main part and the loose part are already falling together. Fanciful TV animations that have steel structures popping and rigging, flinging off the stern in the water column doesn't reflect reality. The process has to leave the stern the wreck we find it today. We're looking for consensus among forensic experts of what did happen. The breakup of Roy Mengot. Survivors testified that the stern righted itself momentarily and then tipped back up, hung there, and slipped after a few minutes. The sequence of events must conform to that scenario and leave the wreck looking as we see it today. The breakup process is shown here as successive conditions. The keel broke first and the sides broke last. As the bow steadily drops, B-deck and heavy shear strake stay connected to the stern momentarily. The stern now arches back to a tipped position. Most of the articles in the broken keel area spill. Now B-deck has bent but maintains its original length. The lower edge of the shell plate suddenly has a longer radius from the hinge area to transverse, but it doesn't stretch either. It bows or bulges out more and separates farther down the keel, retaining it to its original length. This opens the turbine room and even more generator compartments to the sea. Ultimately, the shell plate has to tear into pieces from the bottom up. At this point, the shell plate has separated over a wide area of the stern that large sections fall off, and the entire front half of the stern floods rapidly and sinks minutes later. It is also probable that the port and starboard sides broke at slightly different times. This asymmetric breaking of sides would cause the differences in how the stern appears today. Since the ship was listing slightly to port, the stern might have a tendency to rotate slightly to starboard while the bow, powered only gravity, tends to move slightly to port. This would set up a twisting motion in any remaining hull section plates still connected. Roy Mengot's theory role with the superstructure. As stated, Roy Mengot's theory states that the forward and aft tower, with the other minor debris like the galley decks, boiler rooms, forward cylinders, forward engine, staterooms, and the double bottom, were formed due to the compression stresses acting with the ship, causing it to bend and break into sections, or into pieces, as the cracks ran around the expansion joint, causing it to break in half. The final plunge, which happened at around 2:15 to 2:16 a.m. The Titanic keeps rising and stress builds up on both keel and the structures above, near the third funnel, base, and the aft grand staircase. Bending and rumbling noises are heard. At around 2:17 a.m., the ship begins to rise higher, as high as around 20 to 23 degrees. As it reaches that, tension and compression stresses work on the ship, bending it further. The expansion joint is trying to hold the Titanic. Thus, the cracks on the top run around the ship, splitting it into sections. The keel pushes the engines up a bit, making the ship split into the four major sections we see today, which is the aft tower, the forward tower, and the stern and bow sections. As the cracks finally meet, the stern slowly sails back into the water. Personal thoughts on the formation of the towers, or my breakup theory. One of my personal thoughts on the breakup is that the ship initially breaks just in front of the third funnel. After that, the bottom-up scenario still happens here, but with a few changes. During the bottom-up process, it bends the structure above, making it slowly break open and fail. The cracks above also spread, but this time also runs down. The cracks spread out and radiate outwards around the ship, going down the hull and around the body of the ship, just around the base of the third funnel. Both top-down and bottom-up cracks meet. The ship bends and breaks, crashing on the ocean. The forward tower falls above the ocean. For this support survivor account, seeing the ship break into more sections and seeing the forward tower fall into the sea. Some of these survivor accounts. One of the amazing story which proves the forward tower of the ship itself splitting into more section is on boat two. One of the survivors there, namely seaman Frank Osman, boat two also had a great story, for it went back for the ship the moment it sank. But even though it in fact didn't return to the ship, but still attempted to, was amazing. Now, with boat 2 just rounding the Titanic's propellers at around 2:15 to 2:16 a.m. Others just report seeing the Titanic's lights turn off or go out, and that's it. But one of the most interesting survivors there was seaman Frank Osman. One of his quotes in his testimony says, "We pulled astern that way. And after, we got astern. We lay on our oars and saw the ship go down. After she got to a certain angle, she exploded, broke in halves, and it seemed to me as if all the engines and everything that was in the after part slid out into the forward part. And the after part came up right again. And as soon as it came up right down it went again. But according to simulations that I have ran myself as well, this is impossible. So more likely, he saw the forward tower fall from the stern." As to what had happened during the breakup of the ship, another is by Thomas Whiteley, a survivor that was aboard who may also claim the superstructures fell. He states, "When I got the rope off my leg, I came to the top, made for some wreckage which I hung on to, just in time to see the Titanic blow her sides away. She broke in the middle, her forward, and went down. The aft end righted herself and went right up into the air and disappeared." What he may have also seen here as the forward tower may have been from this sentence, on which he says that her sides have been blown away, for which it may seem. There were also dozens of accounts from Mrs. Chaffee and many more others, like people's in boats 9, 15, and collapsible A. The breakup of the ship made the stern not last very long. The tower sections fall to the ocean, crushing survivors down below. The aft tower remains only just attached to the stern section. The stern settles back for about a minute before 2:18 a.m., at which it begins to rise again at 285 to 90 degree angle. Then, 2 minutes later, April 15th, 1912, in the year of our Lord, 1912, it vanishes by 2:20 a.m., leaving 1,496 survivors to die.